Hi everyone, this is Jason here from Nathaniel. In this lesson, I'm going to introduce you to 10 of my melody writing strategies for all of you piano players out there. Well, pretty much anyone out there, whether you're a guitar player, a singer, or a music producer, or an arranger, or whatever it may be. These are just 10 writing strategies for a melody, which I think will help you all grow as a musician, as well as, of course, make your own songs. So let's get cracking right away. But we have one thing to do before we start. That's hit that subscribe button, hit the bell, follow us on Patreon if you'd like. You'll have all the notes ready and waiting for you for this lesson and everything we've done in the past, now, and also in the future. Let's get started. So the first strategy while writing a melody is to look at chords, but look at a minimum of two chords. Don't think that you're going to make a melody or a very catchy melody on one chord. All the great composers will at least use two chords. So figure out what your two chords are. And for these two chords of choice, you could use a topic of music called cadences. We've done a lot of videos explaining cadences in detail. For example, in this lesson, I'm going to talk about maybe the 5-1. In this case, G, maybe a 5-7, going to 1. So the platform for making the melody or growing the melody, in my opinion, should always be a minimum of two chords. So this is an authentic or a perfect cadence. You go 5-1. So you find that every note has its own place and eventually finds its resting point. You know, you have ta-da. You also have the da-da. So what happens there?
Going to E,
and then you also have
a B going to C.
And what I did right there was a melody, if you think about it, right? So you could just hold these chords and sing something and then play the next chord and just see what it does to you, you know, as a melody writer, right? And just go with that vibe. Okay, minimum two chords. Right, so that was about building a melody with two chords. Learn your cadences. There are quite a few of them. There will be notes in our PDF on Patreon. Check that out. Let's move on to the next melody writing strategy. So to make a catchy melody, you don't really need to think of a scale. You can just think of the chords of the current chord progression you're working on. Or maybe you just pull two chords out of a hat. For example, A minor going to E minor. Now, what does this give you as a melody writer or as a melody composer? It gives you three working ingredients or three notes for every chord. So at the A minor chord, while the rest of your musicians in the band, like the piano player, the guitar player, are busy just kind of playing all the three notes together and creating a nice pattern maybe, you could take those three notes and make it melodic in nature. One option could be to just sing one note per chord. For example,
two.
What did I sing there? I sang
C, B, C, B.
Or you could do
E.
Just E.
E.
Or you could do
E, G. E, G.
Or you could do
A, E.
So you don't have to just sing one note of the chord in a long, long note kind of way, right? You don't have to do
do.
You have a lot more which you can do in the melody department. You can take that note
do
and make it a bit rhythmic in nature. For example,
do do,
right? Depending on the words you have printed in front of you, of course, if you're using words to write your melody. Okay, so you can also sort of use multiple chord tones for that chord, as long as you use the notes of the A minor chord, which is A, C, E. A, C, E. And then the next chord you use, E, G, B. You should be fine. So let's play with that for a bit.
Tum pum pum, parero rum pum pum.
Or
tum tum turu re re ru. Ta-ra, the ta-ra.
All this is happening with just two chords, guys. Imagine what will happen if we do more chords, right? So let's move on to the next melody writing strategy. I hope you found the chord tone thing useful, and it also seems quite obvious, doesn't it? Chords, melody also from the chords, seems obvious. Let's move on. So a very important thing about writing a melody is to give your notes different durations. You don't want to make one note and the next note and the next note and the next note be of the same note value. For example, this may be not such a great melody. You know, it's just going on and on and on in the same rhythm pattern or the same duration per note. So how do we fix that? Make some notes shorter or squeeze some notes, make them faster, and then make another note longer. And the longer note, in my opinion, and in most people's opinions, is called as the landing note. You try to make that longer note generally at the first beat of the bar or at the strong beat of the bar or landing on a chord tone, you know. So for example, if you take this chord progression, A flat going to C minor, you could first of all look at starting your melody by going A flat, which is the root of this chord, going to C minor, C minor, C, A flat, C. Quite long, right? Each chord. So what you could do to make this more interesting is to figure out a way to take or to travel from this chord to the next chord. So for what we call as passing notes and landing notes. So if you take
la da 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 de, de.
So I landed on ta-ra and I made that quite long. I landed on the E flat. So let's try and look at a concept where I land on C minor, a C of the C minor, then next time I land on the E flat of the C minor, and then I land on the G of the C minor. And what are my chords again? A flat major going to C minor. So you go
la da 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 de.
Try another permutation.
La da 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 da.
Now let's try and go to E flat.
La da 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 de, de, da.
That's E flat, right?
La da da.
Land on E flat. So whatever I did in the quicker notes were the passing notes. So I'm using notes of the scale in which I'm on, or trying to build a scale to eventually take my character towards the next land, which in this case is E flat. Let's try going A flat landing to G.
La, da, da, de.
You find that G is actually under A flat. So why do you want to go
la, da, de, de, de.
That also sounds quite nice, going to the high G, but you could also do the low G. You see, so many melodic possibilities exist when you just have two chords, you understand the chord tones, and then you set up a scenario where some of your melody notes function as passing notes, while the other note or the other set of notes, which are longer in duration generally and which occur at strong beats and chord tones, will be your landing notes, right? Right, you may be a bit shocked by what I just did in a melody composing lesson. I did a rhythm and I just did some kind of body percussion groove. But if you treat this, if you treat the hit points of what I hit right now, and if you also acknowledge that some hits happened at a lower pitch, this one for instance, and this one a higher pitch. This one, right? Now, what can this inspire you to do? Now, if you just keep your hand on maybe C, D, E flat, F, G, basically five notes, and I'm just going to build a melody with pretty much these five notes. But if I go, that has nothing to do with the rhythm pattern I just did. I did, this is what I did. So now I want my melody to follow those hit points. So you could either transcribe this, notate it if you read sheet music, notate what you did very organically or very naturally. Or don't bother notating it. If you can figure it out on the piano, that's one step saved, I guess. So you go. So that's one option, isn't it? I've literally trapped my five fingers just to do that. And it can sound quite creative, as you just heard. Which is, that was the rhythm. Build this. This is a great melodic writing strategy when your brain is like completely fried. You don't know what to do. You don't know what. You don't even know if something is going to actually come out of you for a melody, you know. But just tell yourself, make a rhythm pattern, see what comes organically, and then convert that into a melody. For example, quite catchy, right? At least I think so. Anyway, let's move on to the next melody writing strategy. Right, guys, so another interesting melody writing strategy which I have for you is just literally pick four notes, any four. Let's say I'm picking C, D, E, G. Okay, and I just keep playing them. 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, so on. Now, the first strategy would be to think of these just as notes and don't really care about the timing of the notes. Rather, care about how much you're going to be subdividing your brain while you play these notes. So if you play them and let's say you're dividing by two, you go 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 4 and now you have other opportunities or other slots for these notes to be placed into. For example, you could place the E, which is at the third beat, and displace it slightly before what is before 2.5, isn't it? 1 and 2 and 3 and there we have it. And 2 and 3 and 4 and 1. I think that's a lot more nicer than doing a rather sleepy set of four crotchets or quarter notes. Rather, and 2 and 3 and 4 and 2. And you can even then split it up further or divide your beat further into 16th notes and go 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4E and a 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4E and a 1E and a 2E 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 and a other thing you could do is you could build bigger phrases out of a simpler phrase. For example, so I'm just repeating this. This starts getting a bit monotonous. So a good strategy will be, and two and three. Don't start at the one of the next bar. Rather, start a little earlier if you'd like. You can go, and two and three and four and one and two. Now you've got yourself pretty much a complete melody. Normal. As opposed to, sort of boring, right? Compared to... And you have a gap also there, so that gap will kind of inspire your brain to maybe add some kind of an answer to this statement, you know, like... In that gap. Right, so that's about beat displacement, which will really help you move forward with a melody writing strategy just using four notes. C, D, E, G in this case. Let's move on. Right, so in the world of melody writing, there is one scale which I guarantee you will never fail. Right, or will never fail you. That is the pentatonic scales. Actually, there are two scales. There's the major pentatonic. 1, 2, 3, 5, 6. Pentatonic means five notes. Or you have the minor pentatonic. 1, 3 flat, 4 flat, 5, 7 flat. Octave. Now the thing about these two pentatonic scales, they work over almost any diatonic chord progression or even other chord progressions. Anything which, any set of chords. So if you have a group of musician friends who are just playing a few chords, you know, and it seems normal or popish enough, you can just sing the pentatonic scale over any chord and it will generally work. So right now I'll demonstrate... F minor pentatonic, which is F, A flat, B flat, C, E flat. This kind of works on any chord progression. Right? That is D flat, E flat, whatever it may be. Same thing goes with the major pentatonic scale. You just kind of get carried away and create some very spontaneous music, right? And it's also the scale used for a lot of your guitar solos and keyboard solos, which everyone finds very easy on the ear to kind of explore because it just works. So that's about the pentatonic scale, which is another very, very useful melody writing strategy. Let's move on. Right, so you may already kind of know this. To make a great melody, you have singers and they just sing the melody. You may wonder, how did they create that? How did they compose that? What did they conceptualize? Well, in my opinion, at least as a piano player and a person who can kind of hold a note fairly okay, I actually make most of my tunes either in the shower or just going out, you know, strolling or walking the dog or just chilling out. That's when some of the best melodies you'll ever make come into existence, right? So one is your mind kind of releases itself from the technique of the instrument, especially if you're a producer using a software, using, or an instrumentalist using a keyboard. If you're a singer, it's a different story. But here, let's say you know your chords, you know all the technical stuff, you just don't have that organic X factor to make a melody. That's exactly what you need to start doing now. So let's try and figure out a melody with our voice on C major. Something like... Very vocal, right? And then you try to copy it on the piano if you want to. Right? But the point here which I'm trying to make is making a melody is not... is a very organic process. You saw the earlier strategy where I gave you a rhythm and then it became a melody, right? Here, you just sing something and just try and play it back on the piano or try and arrange what you just sung. And the most important thing is to respect the process of making the melody with your voice, because a lot of people I find are just sort of bathroom singers, as we call ourselves sometimes. We just sing, mumble something and just leave it at that, you know. But we all have cell phones and audio recorders which are on these phones as very good quality apps. Why not come up with something and record it, hear it the next day? I'm sure you will like it. So singing a melody is the most organic way to write one. Let's move on. Right, so if you're an instrumentalist like me, playing the piano or whatever you play, you find that when we practice our instruments, we learn a lot of these patterns, right? And these patterns come in exercises, endless exercises. Like, for example, something like this. If you just take groups of three. People will practice that going up and down the scale. Maybe down the scale. Now this to me feels like an exercise, but it feels like an exercise only if you don't see the light at the end of the tunnel, so to speak. Now here's the trick for you. You simplify this exercise or any tricky piano or guitar, whatever exercise, and that's a melody, in my opinion. For example, you do stop there a little bit, you know. Instead of going, instead, sounds quite nice to me. Add some chords, right? Or you take these four notes, build a pattern using those four notes. Just confine yourself to those four notes. Don't keep continuing the exercise. That's an exercise. So I'm not here to discourage you from doing the exercise. Please do the exercise, definitely. But whenever you want to kind of relax your fingers, take a break, chill out from the muscular effort of going through the exercise, slow it down, relax a bit, enjoy yourself, and you make a melody through the same exercise. So what I've learned with scales over my experience of playing this art form is you have big scales, or what we call as the parent scales, or in Carnatic music they call them as Melakarta ragas, which are 7-note scales. Now 7-note scales for a Western musician are great because you can form chords out of any 7-note scale by building triads, by building quartal chords, by building 7th chords and whatnot. However, what about the melody, right? The scale, the bigger raga gives you, or the bigger set of 7 notes gives you the scale. It also gives you melodies. But what if you just knock off 2 of those 7 notes and create like smaller subset scales, as I call them, or as we call them, I think, in a lot of classical contexts in India, Janya ragas. So what you could do is if you take a scale like D, maybe this scale where you do a major third, flat 6, flat 7. We call that, actually, come to think of it, as the Mixolydian flat 6 scale. So major scale with a flat 6, flat 7. I use this a lot. Now let's say we build a scale or subset or a Janya rag scale. Just that. Don't play the ma or the 4. Don't want that. Or maybe don't play the 3. I don't know what the official names are for these scales, but they sure sound good, even if I play them up and down. Don't want the C. Well, you could bring it in, but what I'm trying to tell you is start with a big scale and clear up a couple of notes and what you have is a very, very catchy sound, which may just give you the melody, you know. Another example could be you take the major scale and maybe knock off the three. So that leaves you 1, 2, 4, 5. Don't want the 6. And just keep the 7. Right? Creates a very nice, pleasing sound. Right? If you think about it, this is pretty much rag des. Right? So that's the small scale, which just becomes a very, very catchy melody. So I have one final melody writing strategy, which you may find a little controversial. Right, so this strategy is a little bit, I wouldn't say this is very popular and part of a textbook at least, but it could work and it has worked for me, but the whole process revolves around kind of ripping off or stealing other melodies or riffs in songs and just seeing what you can do with that riff or that other melody using the hit points of those notes or using the scales of those notes and see what happens. So for example, if you take right, you know this song by Bruno Mars, right? I don't think I can play the whole song for you, otherwise this entire lesson is going to be taken down. But yeah, or maybe let's just take a riff. Bam, 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 bam. That one. And now let's see what we can do. Taken a very cheesy riff like that, or maybe ta na 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 na. And what can we do? You could take any of your favorite songs. It could be a riff, it could be a melody sung by anyone, and just see where it goes. You're not really spoiling the melody, you're not, and I think you'll be fine. You'll not be sued by anyone for doing this. Try it out, but be a bit careful. You want to like completely change the melody, right? You don't want to rip off, let's say, a Coldplay song and then you get a call from them someday. It will actually be quite cool, come to think of it. Okay, right guys, so these are 10 ways or 10 melody writing strategies which I hope you can use in your music. I'm sure there are a lot more, and in the comments you could also give me your thoughts as to how you generally compose melodies, any challenges you face while writing them, and we can probably script out a few more lessons which can help you towards these goals, right? Some notes are there on Patreon as usual. Lot of my notes are always there. Go ahead there, and it'll be great if you can go there and support our channel. If you'd like to learn with our music school virtually, we have our courses, our full-length 4-month cycles. Do head over to our website, nathanielschool.com, which will be in the description. You can fill up a form and one of our team members will reach you. And that's about it. And let's make the video go big as well, if possible. Give us a like or a thumbs up. You know, leave us a comment, share the video with your musician friends, and thanks a ton for watching. Cheers.